Good morning. Good morning and welcome. It's great to be here with you this morning. We're glad that you can worship with us. If you're worshiping through the TV or internet, we welcome you. Ask that you would take a moment and fill out the red pew pad as we get started here in worship and pass that towards the center. Hey, I don't think we have any announcements today. As you're filling those pew pads out, let's all stand as we join in this morning's call to worship. We confess, O God, that we have wandered off the pathway as we have journeyed through Lent. We talk with everyone but you. We confess that we have fallen short of our goal to eat better during this time of reflection and regrouping, and we have failed to stick to the plan we had to exercise faithfully as we journey with you during Lent. God of second chances, as we pause in the middle, shake us up and turn us forward to walk with you in the light of your love, that we might ultimately share this light and love with others. Amen. Let's continue to stand as we sing hymn number 301.
Thank you.
Shall we greet one another? Invite the children to come forward at this time. How are we doing this morning? Good. It was almost like we rehearsed that. That was great. Good job. Hey, I want to share something with you that's probably not a big secret, but or a surprise for that matter, but I grew up on a farm. It probably doesn't surprise you, does it? Nope. But, and you know, a lot of illustrations and stories that I share about the Bible, it seems like I end up using stories about growing up on the farm for some reason or another, maybe because it works for me, and hopefully it works for you. And you know what? Even in the Bible, Jesus talked about things that deal with agriculture, which really is farming. So we're going to talk a little bit this morning about something that I learned growing up on the farm. And it's the difference between a horse and a cow, okay? Now, I know it seems like it's quite obvious, right? One you would put a saddle on and ride around, and one you probably wouldn't, unless you want to be a professional bull rider. Josiah, anybody have any aspirations to do that? Want to be a professional bull rider? No? Good choice. Good choice. Probably break a leg. But let me tell you something. There's a reason why we ride horses and not so much cows, because I'm going to tell you something else, and I don't use this word a lot in our household, but cows are dumb, okay? I think they're probably one of the dumber animals. Now, I appreciate cows because they do a lot of wonderful things for us, but they're not really that smart. And I'll tell you why, because a horse, now, help me out, Braden. The cowboys wear these things on the back of their boots, and they kind of stick out, and they jingle and jangle and go clang when you walk. Do you remember what those things are called? I can't remember what they're called. Not cowboy boots. They have, yeah. Horses? Yeah. Oh, no, horses aren't stupid. Sorry. What's that? Thanks for coming over. Yeah, they're some kind of spikes, and they're called spurs, okay? And cowboys wear spurs because when they're riding horses, if they just, now they don't really get after the horse too much with them, but if they just kind of touch the horse on the side with the spurs, that horse will move over. So horses are really good at of moving away. They gallop, yeah. And so they move, I'm going to use the term, they yield to pressure. Okay, if you're a horse person, that probably makes sense to you. But what that means is, if I start pushing on you, you're going to try to go that way, right? And you're not going to turn around and try to fight me back. Now, a cow, on the other hand, remember what I said about cows. If I go up and start pushing on you like this, if you're a cow, you're going to lean right back in. And cows do just the opposite. When there's a little pressure put on them, they turn around and they want to just push right back. Okay? Now, you probably have no idea why I'm talking about this, but I'm using this, a story from real life, to give you an illustration or to help you understand a spiritual thing. Okay? And we see that happen a lot in the Bible too. And the reason why I say that is because we want to be like horses. All right? Now, here's why. When God starts working on us or nudging us, He wants us to respond by not fighting back, by pushing back. And if we acted like a cow, God would say, hey, I want you to work on this in your life. We'd turn around and we'd push back and we'd say, no, thank you. I've got this on my own. But if we're a horse, we yield to that. We allow God to move us in the direction that He wants us to go. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Nod your head if it makes sense. Nod your head if it doesn't make sense. Perfect. All right. Let's pray. And then we're going to have children's collection, all right? Dear God, I thank you that there's so many things that are going on around us that can help us understand spiritual matters. And God, we know that you care about each one of us, that you have a plan for each one of us. But we also know that that won't happen unless we yield to you, unless we allow you to move us in the direction that you want us to go. So we ask for hearts that are obedient and submissive to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
As the children complete their collection, the ushers will wait on you for your morning offering. The choir will assemble and be ready for the anthem.
You know? I don't know.
Is that one we thought was the greatest?
I found it. Just a second. Got it. They can edit that out on TV, no big deal.
The light.
Lord, we give you thanks this day for every good gift. We know, Lord, that you are the provider of every good gift, and all that we have belongs to you. From that, we bring back a portion, we lay it at your feet, asking, Lord, you use these gifts for your kingdom here and around the world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated, but still turn in your hymnal, if you will. I want you to turn in your hymnal to number 297. Remain seated.
I was going to say, please be seated. And I turned around and figured out that I was the only one standing. As we gather together, God calls us to come to his throne in our morning prayer. So let's bow our heads and unite our hearts as we open up ourselves to the prayer that we have this morning. Our Father in heaven, we come before you on this beautiful spring morning. We recognize, Father, that there's that promise of spring that has been kind of hidden from us these last few days, but all of a sudden things begin to bloom. And spring has arrived. And again, we are reminded of the promise of new life that comes to us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. We come into this Lenten season, this time when we prepare our hearts and minds for Easter. We think about the commitments that we have made. And as our prayer this morning opened up the ideas that sometimes we fail in those commitments. And we know, Father, that we do fail, and we ask your forgiveness. We ask your forgiveness when we fail to reach out to someone in need, when we fail to lift up our prayers for those who are in need because of sickness or injury or aging, whatever it might be. We know, Father, that when we fail, you offer forgiveness, just like you offered forgiveness to the thief on the cross long ago that was there with Jesus during that horrible time of crucifixion. But we know, Father, that Jesus promised to him that he would be with him in paradise. And we know that we come together in this Easter season recognizing the wonder of the resurrection, the idea that Jesus took their sins and our sins to the cross with him and died there for each one of us. And we are thankful for that. We lift up to you this morning any of our congregation who might be suffering, who might have special needs. So we lift them up to you, and we ask that you will guide us and direct us into the places where we can be an extension of your hand as we reach out to those needs. Be with us now, Father, as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Early in the days in which I had first gotten here into town, one of the youth that I had met the earliest was Isaac Bowens. And I'm asking Isaac to read the scripture today, and he has been willing to do just that. So Isaac is going to come to read, and while he's coming, what do you need to know about Isaac? He's a sophomore here at Titusville in high school, and Isaac loves Jesus. Please come, Isaac.
Good morning, church. Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there, along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes and casting lots. For the people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him with wine vinegar and said, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him, which read, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise."
Thank you, Isaac. I just want to remind you folks, as well as those who might be listening online and those watching the television show today, I want to remind you how we're going to be handling Holy Week. Holy Week is really a precious time, and I've been part of it where we've made everyone so busy where they could not be very holy, to tell you the truth. And I want to remind you that when you prepare for Easter on that Holy Week, you really want to be ready for a very good day. You want to make sure that you're at peace with God. You want to make sure that you have examined your heart and your mind. So there are a couple things that we've designed that week to be able to do that. First of all, on Thursday night, we'll get together for the Maundy Thursday service. That service will be taking place. There will be a communion offered that night. We'll be taking communion by intention that night so that you can plan for that. The communion will take place on that evening. It'll be an intimate gathering. Before we have communion that night, right at 7 o'clock, we will show a piece called The Sand Story, or The Passion of Christ, by Joe Castillo. He's an artist that's put together an art form where he can transform the sand into the face of Jesus onto the cross and back and forth. And it's about 17 minutes long that night. So instead of preaching, we're going to be showing that and let you contemplate the work of Christ, and then we'll share with communion together. But I have just a short trailer for you to see Joe Castillo, and I want you to see what his form is. And by the way, the soundtrack is from the movie The Passion of Christ that Mel Gibson had put together. So you're going to recognize some of the music, but just a little glimpse of what we'll do that Thursday night. So that will take place, and then we'll have communion after that. It should be an intimate gathering. And that may be part of your tradition to be here on that Thursday night, may not be. But I want to remind you that it's such a very precious time when we'll look into one another's eyes and remind ourselves of the price that Jesus paid for us. Then on Good Friday, there'll be excellent services all around town. Instead of hosting a Good Friday service, we are going to be opening up our sanctuary space from 12 o'clock noon till 6 in the evening to accommodate any who might be coming from work. There will be some prayer guides and some scripture for you to read. You just come and take that sheet, sit down anywhere in the place you want to, and just quietly prepare your hearts and remember the price that Jesus paid for you and for me on that day. Then when you come back at Easter, don't show up Easter morning unless you've already given your heart to Christ and checked into what it means to confess sin and come more like ready, prepared to do it. Now, early in the morning, we are invited out to Wesley Woods for the sunrise service. And if you are interested in eating breakfast out there after the sunrise service, you need to tell the office, and we will make those reservations out of Wesley Woods. But we're part of the sunrise service and welcome out there. And then we'll come back, and service will be at 8:30 and 11. But between the two services, there'll be the Easter breakfast or brunch, I guess that's still breakfast at that time, between the two services, since there are five Sundays in that month, and we'll be hanging out together during that time between the two services, trying to greet one another and celebrate that day of the resurrection. Just wanted you to be aware of those things. For the last few weeks, we have been talking about witnesses to the death of Jesus on the cross. Judas, of course, never made it to the day of the cross. Last week, we spoke about Mary, the mother of Jesus, and John. And do you remember last week when we were letting the children spot where all the crosses are all over this building? And I knew that there'd be some of you who would spend the rest of the day counting the crosses. And that's from the pews and the hymnals to all the services. I saw some really large numbers here. One person told me as many as 2,700. I haven't counted to verify that yet, by the way, but going by everywhere where they can find crosses in here. So the one thing, though, that I did not know, and of course, I've been here now, 8 months, something like that. And this week, as I was walking through the sanctuary and looking, I found out the window right up there behind Bert. There's a window at the very back behind the balcony that's Jesus hanging on the cross, and guess who's underneath her at the foot of Jesus is Mary and John. So having preached on that last week, I had not been observant enough to know that one of our windows way up behind the balcony is given to that very scene. But today, we're looking at the two thieves, one on the left-hand side of Jesus, one on the right-hand side of Jesus, all of them being crucified on the cross. And the question comes to you today, will you be able to identify with the one who hurled insults to Jesus right up to the last minute? Or can you identify with the one who says, this day, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom? Whenever I work at the Gospels, I don't have a scholarly background, but I work under the understanding that most likely Mark was the first one written. Then Matthew builds on that a little bit. Luke contains some of that material that's in one or the other. And then the Gospel of John is under like a different type of strategy the way that gospel is put together. But I usually figure that Mark was the first one. And if I get to heaven and find out I'm wrong, I'm okay with that. I think I'm going to find out a lot of things someday. But please understand this. When we talk about Mark, all four gospels mention that when Jesus died, two others died on either side of him, okay? But it's when we get to Mark that they're called bandits. And the word that Mark used was a Greek word called lesthi. And of course, it means a violent criminal. Probably Mark was written very close to the time, not too far from the time in which the Romans had come in and just destroyed the temple in Jerusalem. And the reason they did that was because the Jewish folks kept rebelling against them. And so for the ones who were rebelling against the Romans, they saw themselves as freedom fighters, much like we'd see today. But to the Romans, they were terrorists. And to the Jewish folks who were not looking for armed combat and breakthrough, they were still very frustrating because when the Romans came in, they took out more than the lesthi, they also punished the very people themselves. And so the brutality that came from the Romans was immense. So what Mark does is he identifies these two criminals with those type of things and that type of an individual. The violence that even the Jews felt from them was something that was very uncomfortable for them because they knew that if some of these people battled against the Romans, sure enough, the Romans would come back against them, and they did just that. Now, when it comes to Luke uses a word that's made up of two Greek words, one of them being kaka, which we always with children have always giggled at saying because of just nasty stuff that they're thinking about, okay? But that is the word that's used in a lot of languages. That root is used in a lot of languages, just not in English. So it really means bad stuff. And then ergo is the other half of that one, which means works of bad stuff. So if you can picture that kaka orgoi and just begin to realize that that's the way Luke describes these men as really, really bad men doing really, really bad things. You get the idea of the kind of company that Jesus had whenever he was on the cross. In all of the Gospels, we see that the people around the cross derided Jesus, humiliated him, hurled insults, made fun of him. Religious leaders cried out. He said, he saved others. Let them save himself if he's God's chosen one. You know, so that's a denial of him as Messiah, if ever I've heard one. Soldiers had even said, if you're the king of Jews, save yourself. And if that's not enough, one of the criminals at the side of Jesus also said, are you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. And you can tell by the inflection of what he said, he did not believe that Jesus was the Messiah. And what did the Jewish folks many times want to have? They looked for signs that he was the Messiah. Well, these three statements by three groups, people, just to insult him, and in such a way to tempt him, we find. Because the Gospel of Luke has put together the ministry of Jesus in a kind of a bookend fashion. The beginning of his public ministry was the temptation. Remember that? Where in the wilderness he had been fasting for 40 days and hungry, and the devil points out the stones are out there and says, if you turn these into bread, Then you can have nourishment and eat. And how many of you know that'd be a good thing for a general who's leading a people, an army, to be able to do anyway? And Jesus, of course, rejects that. Secondly, he takes him up and puts him in a high place and says, jump off of here and God will protect you. He won't let you be dashed. You're his son, right? And tempting him to display his power in some way that was not God's way in the first place. And finally, he takes him to a place and he shows him all the kingdoms of the world. He says, if you will just bow down to me, said you will have more power than you ever dreamed of. Isn't it interesting that what the devil was probably trying to do in those early days was kind of steer Jesus away from the purpose he had come, and that was to ultimately die on the cross. And now after he spent this long night in the Garden of Gethsemane praying, and he's been arrested and been tortured and beaten, now he goes to the cross, and it's not done yet. And even while he's on the cross, he said, you say you're the King of Jews. In fact, there was a sign nailed to the cross above him, the King of the Jews, right? You say you're the King of the Jews. Come on down from there. And all three of those people who did that pretty much reflects what Satan was doing with Jesus earlier in the Gospel of Luke. If you're the Son of God, Jesus, then do this. And inherent in that statement is the rejection of who Jesus is. The ones when they said, if you are the Son of God, that tells you that they did not believe that he was the Son of God, okay? And just is not enough. You'd think that after everything he's gone through, that they could just kind of let the guy die in peace, right? But they do not. I ask a question. Could Jesus have come down from the cross? Could he have been spared with that? Remember the song that many of us were used to hearing probably growing up, and even to this day, the song, he could have called 10,000 angels. Take it right out of the scripture. But he died alone for you and me. All this seems to happen after Jesus has already prayed for the soldiers. One of the early things that he has when they're nailing him up here, he says, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. And it's almost like that prayer set them off. Have you ever been around someone whenever you either hint at the faith that is in you or that you love following Christ? Have you ever had an experience where sometimes people just react and they just takes off like that? And that's indicative of those who reject Christ many times. And whenever he had prayed that they would be forgiven for not knowing what to do, it seems like all the abuse and everything came back on Jesus right at that very time. Well, we know this about crucifixion. It's designed for maximum pain and suffering. I'm not a medical doctor, and aren't you glad I'm not one? I'm not a medical doctor, but I do know a little bit, at least enough of what I hear of them explaining it to me. You know, and I understand, how many times have you seen whenever there's an interpreter for the deaf, when they'll talk about Jesus, they'll use the sign of the hands pierced, you know, by the nail. And of course, we're pretty sure that the nail would have gone in here, which for me feels like the wrist, but a place in the bones where it could have been hanging, not here where we're torn through the flesh. So Jesus was on the cross. Many times they also use rope in order to hang him there. You'll see that there's what you and I wrongly call the footstool, that, you know, where they got their feet on, kind of holding them up. But that was not a very good thing. It was just literally to tempt them to try to get down to take the pain, or to push up to take the pain off their arms. But to get up like this, they had to pull both on their arms, tearing at the hand, and also their feet, which were wearing out. And at least some of, you know, they explained to me anyhow that they didn't die from loss of blood. It was more fluid begins building up around the lungs. And if you've ever been with anybody who's having trouble breathing, whenever that fluid builds up around the lungs, it's one of the scariest, most panicky things I get to see when I'm around people many times. And so they had to even speak, then they'd have to push themselves up to take a breath and then speak. And what that means is the thief on the one side of Jesus, who was ready to hurl an insult, was already dying, was already in the throes of the beginning of what was going to happen to him, and he wanted so much to join in the ridiculing of Jesus that he pushed himself up all the way with whatever pain it took and with every breath that he was able to take, and he says, if you are the Messiah, save yourself and us. What is it about us that wants to ridicule people right to the very end of the lives many times? I started out the service in the early one, and maybe I'll just stop and do this the way I did in the early service today. You know how in when you see AA meetings, that the person will introduce himself, they'll say only their first name, and then everyone will say hi. So I'm going to introduce myself, by the way, as if I'm in a meeting of some kind. And I want you to say, hi, Larry, back, okay? And also, I want you to be looking about anyone who doesn't say it as well and let me know afterwards. Okay. All right, here we go. I'm Larry, and I am a sinner who has fallen short of the glory of God.
Hi, Larry.
But church, you have known sin and fallen short of the glory of God. Say, hi, church. Hi, church.
Hi, church.
Now, let me try this again. I'm Larry, and I have been redeemed by the death of Jesus on the cross.
Hi, Larry.
You are the church. You have been redeemed by the death of Jesus on the cross.
Hi, church.
You learned fast. Good job. What does Paul say in Romans? For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Why is it that in the middle of my week, even this week, I found myself either going to ridicule or thinking about someone the wrong way or starting to talk to someone else the wrong way? What is it about us that makes us feel better whenever we can point out what someone else's deficiencies are? What is that about? Even for the thief on the cross, it seems like to the last minute, he was not only able, but just deciding to put Jesus in his place and to remind him that he didn't think too much of him. But the other one rebuked his partner, and in that rebuke, he defends Jesus. Somewhere along the line, there's been a change of heart. Metanoia, in some way, a repentance, something that starts in a, you know, we often describe it as going one direction and going another direction, but it starts almost with a change of heart that becomes a change of the mind, that becomes a change in the action and in our words. And so this particular criminal experienced just that. There was some kind of a change that took place, and it became a change of mind, and an action to take place, and he rebukes the one who was ridiculing Jesus. I like this passage in Ephesians 4:29. Let me just read it to you. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. Now, the one thing that I have found, I like that when I find that I have failed, I find comfort in thinking that other people did as well, you know. But could there be a conversation this last week where the words you spoke or the attitudes you conveyed were not intended to build up someone that you were talking about? Is that possible? And we remember, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But the disciple who went through a change of heart and mind was drawn towards Jesus, and what does he say? Jesus, when you come into your kingdom, remember me. He evidently had a background of something in the scriptures, because he understood that every time that God remembered the people of Israel, he was about ready to rescue them. I love this. You know, when he remembered the Israelites that were slaves in Egypt, and then God rescues them. When he remembered some of the ones during the period of Judges, then he rescues them shortly after that memory is taking place. Jesus, remember me, he said. Well, it brings me to the question, do you believe in deathbed conversions? I have a picture, an image here. By the way, this is Billy Graham, and was asked that question in 2007, and he's answered it many times, and he certainly understood why it happened. But the person that asked that question wanted to know about his friend who was waiting till the last minute before they die, and then they were going to confess. They understand a little bit about God's grace, you know, but when they ask that question, they don't understand the heart of God. You get me? Because what can I do right up to the last minute and then ask God to forgive me and make a mockery out of the grace of God? So Billy Graham handled that type of thing, and of course he explained to them it was possible. So I've got a picture here of just of a woman ministering to a gentleman here, and who is an end of life situation in some shape or form, and it called to mind of an instance I had early in my ministry, where a gentleman did not come to church. His wife did come to church, and he was not only not coming to church, but he was probably violently against coming there. And I've worked with marriages like that sometimes, where the women are coming, and even if they make a gift or offering in the plate, they say, "Please don't tell my husband." One of those kind of things. That's kind of where we're at with this one. But when he was dying, and he really was on his deathbed, hospice was caring for him, she wanted to know if I would come see him. And I said, well, I would be willing to see him. And when I showed up there, it was like he had enough energy to let me know with his eyes that he did not want to see me. How's that sound? That's probably the best way for me to ever say it. And I asked anyway. I said, are you at peace with God? And that brought back thrashing. There was, and I interpreted that he was not at peace with God. And so when I prayed, I pray what I often do. Thank you, Jesus, for taking away a sin. Forgive me, forgive us, forgive my friend. And whatever the case was, it seemed like he was rejecting everything that we were doing. I don't know what happened. He died within 24 hours. I don't know what happened, but I know this. Everyone who gets to the end of their life does not decide all of a sudden that they want to be have the grace of Jesus put together with them. My father died from pancreatic cancer, and he used to talk about all the time. He said, I think that would be a good way to die. We say, Dad, what are you talking? Not that, but some places we die quickly, he would say, and not suffer. And I understood what he was saying all the meantime. And then all of a sudden, he suffered from pancreatic cancer. And that was about a six-month process from whenever he knew that what he had and going through it. And it was miserable. But Dad had the opportunity in that slow, painful thing that he went through to speak to anyone and everyone who wanted to speak with him. I can remember he paid off the we owed money on the parsonage for the church. He paid that off. He wanted that done. He bought hunting rifles for each of his seven grandchildren. And we have kids in our family that still have those 243 Remingtons all over the place, And just a small deer gun, and they all have them. And granddaughters, they bought dishes for. One person after another would come to visit him, and mother and dad would not tell anyone no. They all were welcome to come see him. And he got to speak to everyone that he wanted to speak. That's the beauty of a slow demise, if there is such a thing. Truth of the matter is, many never get that opportunity to be able to do that. Dad had been a follower of Jesus all his life. But I thought about that, how much he still had the time to clean up everything he worked on finance, worked on every kind of thing he could with mother, and cared for things and was able to do that. But not many of us will have that opportunity. The real question is, how do you feel about Jesus now? When I invite you to follow Jesus, do you find something in your spirit that is like that gentleman I saw on his deathbed that just kind of stiffens up and says, this religious nut is not going to talk me into anything I don't want to do? Or do you find yourself leaning towards Jesus passively as Jerome was trying to explain to the children a little bit earlier? Do you see yourself leaning towards Jesus saying, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom? Let's pray together. Lord, for everyone in this place and all within hearing distance of my voice, the appeal comes from you, Lord. Will you remember us? And the promise is you will, should we respond. We now know that that thief on the cross was never baptized, never went to a discipleship class, never joined a church, never took a spiritual gift inventory. But because of the change of heart, Jesus welcomed him into the kingdom that very day. I believe there are hearts in this place. I believe there are hearts online and hearts watching this broadcast. I believe, Lord, that there are hearts who are leaning towards you right now, saying, Jesus, remember me. Like Larry, I have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But we also remember that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly, and that you welcome us into your kingdom. And so, Lord, for everyone in this place and everyone watching, we confess our sin. And we are trusting only in you. The thief on the cross had nothing more than the hope of Jesus while he died. And that's what we have now, and nothing else. The hope of Jesus and the price he paid for us. Holy Spirit, move through this place. Move through our community. Move wherever this message can go and draw us to you. And Jesus, remember us. Amen. We're going to sing this last song, just really two verses, Blessed Assurance. But I want you to sing it like a people are redeemed. Will you stand? Sing it joyfully. Sing it knowing what God has done for you. I know for so many of you, you sang that with great joy, what God has already done in your life, and looking forward to the kingdom that he has for you forever and ever. If you're struggling with that, please know that I'm willing to talk with anyone at any time. There is nothing more important than we do. Go in peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.